Turning your King James Bible to the book of 1 Timothy, continuing the study of pre-trib rapture scriptures, decimating, destroying the satanic papal heresy of post-trib rapturism, which is exactly what it is. It's the Catholics that have been teaching for years and years that the church needs further purification by going through this future tribulation time period. It's the Catholics that can't believe that Christians could be immediately called up to be with the Lord in eternity, thereby eliminating purgatory. It's the Catholics that couldn't imagine the whole church being taken off the earth, because the Catholics, you see, believe in temporal as well as spiritual authority. So if the church, Christ's church, is taken from the earth, who's going to rule and reign with the office of the Pope? See, that'd be a problem. So it's the Catholics, it is a papal teaching, this whole post-trib system. Absolutely. That's why they'll refer to the church fathers, not talking about the pre-trib rapture or the early church, the old church, the early church. You see, way back in the first couple centuries there, where the government, Rome, was transforming into the Roman Catholic system, it went from a government to a religion. And it's still a political authority too, by the way, the most powerful political authority on the earth. When it was morphing, they were killing and murdering Christians. They always have. So they say, they just, you know, slaughtering people, going in, murdering whole, you know, villages of people, whole, just slaughtering people over and over again. You know, millions of Christians down through the centuries. And then they say, where are the writings that proved a pre-trib rapture? Where are the writings of, you know, the early Christians and stuff? All we have is the church fathers, and they agree with our teachings. Gee, I wonder why that would be. Could it be because you were killing and burning the writings of real Christians, heretics, down through the centuries? Well, let's start out here. I could go off about Catholicism. For a long time, 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the commandment of God our Savior and Lord Jesus Christ, which is our hope. Unto Timothy, my own son in the faith, grace, mercy, and peace. There it is again. From God our Father and Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, if you've been keeping up with these studies, you know that over and over and over again, Paul is promising peace to Christians that comes from the Lord. And yet over in Revelation chapter 6, verse 4, we're not going to turn to it because I've done it in all these different videos, so you can just go back and watch the other ones or turn there and read it for yourself. Revelation chapter 6, verse 4, Jesus Christ, the Lamb, opens the seal that takes peace from the earth. Now, boys and girls, this is going to be difficult to understand, okay? So I'll take it slow so the post-tribbers can get it, all right? See, right now they're going, I can't watch anymore, his attitude's bad. Yeah, well, you know, then go away. Go back to watching Britney Spears or sports or whatever other things that you watch. Or, you know, Illuminati exposed videos or something like this, okay? If you really want to know the scriptures, if you really are interested in the Bible, then you'll continue and you'll consider what's being said. Here's the thing. If God promises us peace right now, and God takes peace from the earth, then that would mean that there aren't Christians here, or else God would be a liar. Paul wrote to the body of Christ, the Pauline epistles, from Romans the whole way through to Philemon. That's for us today. Yes, the whole rest of the Bible is given for instruction in righteousness, for doctrine, for reproof, for correction. Yes, that's there. Absolutely. We can read the whole Bible. And there are doctrines that will overlap different dispensations. But our instructions as Bible-believing Christians are found in the Pauline epistles. And we have peace that comes from God. You say, what about the martyrs? I'll get that one all the time. The post-tribbers, that's one of their favorite things. It's kind of funny because Jesus condemned the Pharisees in his day, the scribes, the Sadducees, the Pharisees, those three there, which are all represented in the modern day, I should say, by Roman Catholicism. But Jesus condemned them back then. He said, you build and garnish the tombs of the martyrs, and yet by your words, by your testimony, you prove that you were the ones that killed them. And you'll hear the Catholics talking about the martyrs, the Christian martyrs and stuff like this. They're the ones that murdered them. And I get this thing from these post-trib heretics that are papists, and they'll say, what about the martyrs? What about the martyrs? They had to suffer. Do you think that you're going to get out without suffering? And I always say to them, okay, at whose hand did those martyrs suffer? You see, because in the book of Revelation, it's Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, that opens the seals. It's God's judgment that comes down on a Christ-rejecting world. God never persecuted a martyr. It was a Catholic church. And God's never been behind the Catholic church. Problem number one for post-trib heretics. But let's continue. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 3 through 10. Let's read this. Again, we're going to see some more proof for the body of Christ leaving before the time of Jacob's trouble. That's the real term. The time of Jacob's trouble there is what I meant. Verse 3, as I besought thee to abide still at Ephesus when I went into Macedonia, that thou mightest charge some that they teach no other doctrine, neither give heed to fables and endless genealogies, which minister questions rather than godly edifying, which is in faith, so do. Stop right there. Let me ask you a question. What is going to give you more questions if we get raptured before the time of Jacob's trouble, or if we have to go through it? That's going to give you a lot of questions. Minister questions. These doubts that are being given to these people, they minister questions. Interesting. And godly edifying, by the way, is the opposite of questions being ministered. And who was it that asked the first question in the Bible? Yea, hath God said. You can look that up on your own. Verse 5. Now the end of the commandment is charity out of a pure heart and of a good conscience and of faith unfeigned. Oh boy, do I love that one. Faith unfeigned. I believe Jesus died for my sins, but I'm not sure if he can take me out of here before his wrath comes. You have faith? So let me get this straight. You can say that you have faith that Jesus died for your sins and that was enough to pay for your sins and that you're going to go to heaven when you die, but you don't have faith that he can take you out of here. It's a little weird, isn't it? Very weird. Look at verse 6. From which some, having swerved, have turned aside unto vain jangling. All these people worried about the Mark of the Beast technology coming in. I only talk about that stuff just to warn people, say, you better get saved so you can get out of it. All these people, it's going to come and we're going to have to this and we're going to have to that. You better start stockpiling your food right now. What have they done? They swerved. They're vain jangling now. Illuminati death camps and martial law and all this other stuff. And that's all you spend your time on? It's fine to talk about that stuff if you're trying to point people to Jesus Christ for salvation and say, you better get saved quickly because the rapture is coming, and if you miss the rapture, you're going to be here for that stuff. That's one thing. That's fine. I do that. A lot of other Bible believers do that. But if you're telling people that they got to prepare for those times so that because they're going to go through them, that's a problem. You've swerved. You have turned aside unto vain jangling. But look at this, verse 7, desiring to be teachers of the law, understanding neither what they say nor whereof they affirm. We're going to see about this here in a minute. But we know that the law is good if a man use it lawfully, knowing this, that the law is not made for a righteous man, but for the lawless and disobedient, for the ungodly and for sinners, for unholy and profane, for murderers of fathers and murderers of mothers, for manslayers, for whoremongers, for them that defile themselves with mankind, for men stealers, for liars, for perjured persons, and if there be any other thing that is contrary to sound doctrine. What is the purpose of the law right now? Specifically, the Ten Commandments. What's the purpose of it? The law is our schoolmaster to bring us to Christ. You see, Jesus Christ died for sinners. He didn't come to call the righteous. He came to call sinners to repentance. You see? So how do you convict somebody of their sin if there's no law? The law is there to convict of sin, to show somebody from plain, simple English, you're a sinner. If you had to stand before God and he judges you according to just the Ten Commandments, there's a lot more law back in the Old Testament and even in the New Testament. But if God just judged you by those Ten Commandments, you would fail miserably. Nobody's ever able to keep those Ten Commandments. No Jew, no Pharisee, no whatever. No one can keep the Ten Commandments. It's there to convict people of their sin right now. So what are you trying to say? People are going to have to be saved by keeping the law? Oh, no, that's not me saying it. It's what the Bible says. Keep your hand there in 1 Timothy and go back to Revelation chapter 14. Oh, this is heresy. Just shut your mouth for a little bit. Try to learn something, okay? And I speak very blunt. I speak very plainly. I speak very sarcastically because there's no time for playing tiddlywinks, okay? There's no time for playing little fun games, a little children thing, and you know, suck your thumb, you know, and things like that. Take it out long enough to type nasty comments. No. I'm going to speak right to you. You got it? I don't want you coming away saying, well, he's kind of ambiguous. I don't really understand exactly what he believes. You're going to understand what I believe and what I teach and what I preach when you're done watching these videos. And I'm not cocky because I'm proud. I'm cocky because I know what the Bible says. And I'm not going to deceive you. I'm not after your money. Okay? Revelation chapter 14. Okay, I have it written wrong in my notes there. Revelation chapter 14, verse 9 through 12. And the third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, if any man worship the beast and his image, and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation, and he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. And the smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever, and they have no rest, day nor night, who worship the beast and his image, and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name. Okay, real quick there. Verse 9 says, if any man. Verse 11 says, whosoever receiveth the mark. All right, anybody in that time period that takes the mark, they lose any salvation they've had. There's no profession or anything. I don't care what they professed. They go to hell. Now, that's one of the strongest proofs that you know the body of Christ is not going into the time of Jacob's trouble. Because if they did, and some Christian took the mark, worshiped the beast and his image, and that's all one and the same thing, you're not going to get to take the mark and then not worship the beast or something. It's all going to be part of the same thing. If a Christian did that, well, they would lose their salvation and go to hell. And that would cause a contradiction with Ephesians chapter 1, which says that we are, verse 13, which says that we are sealed unto the day of redemption. So you want a proof for a quote-unquote pre-trib rapture? There you have it. Compare Ephesians chapter 1, verse 13, with Revelation 14, verses 9 through 11. But look at verse 12. Here is the patience of the saints, here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Salvation is two parts in that time of Jacob's trouble. You say, I don't believe it. Yeah, I know. Matthew chapter 24. The infamous Matthew 24. I can disprove a pre-trib rapture because you just go to Matthew 24. Okay, let's go to Matthew 24. You see, these people, Paul condemned them in 1 Timothy. They desire to be teachers of the law, understanding not what they affirm, neither what they say. I think I have that order mixed up, but we'll go back and read it here in a minute. Matthew chapter 24, verse 20. You say the Ten Commandments aren't for today. They're not going to be, you know, they've been done away. Jesus did away with the Ten Commandments that we don't need. It's just by grace through faith from now to eternity. Nonsense. People that say that don't understand the Bible. Matthew chapter 24, verse 20. But pray ye that your flight be not in the winter, neither on the Sabbath day. Why would people be worried about the Sabbath day in the future? Well, probably because it says up in verse 16, let them which be in Judea flee into the mountains. What are Bible-believing Christians doing over in Judea? Matthew 24 is written to Jews. Hello. That's why in Mark 13 it talks about they will persecute you in the synagogues. Jews. Very interesting. Turn back to Romans chapter 13. say, well, we're supposed to keep the Sabbath. We're not supposed to worship on a Sunday because that's the mark of the beast. Okay, you know, Seventh-day Adventists, no idea what the Bible teaches. You know, the whole thing, the whole Seventh-day Adventist cult is founded by a woman. Yeah, okay, that's a good foundation. Romans chapter 13, verse 9. Now, if we're supposed to keep the Sabbath day, it's going to appear here because Paul is listing the commandments that we're supposed to keep as New Testament Christians. Check this out. Romans chapter 13, verse 9. For this, thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not bear false witness, thou shalt not covet. And if there be any other commandment, it is briefly comprehended in this saying, namely, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. What in the world, Paul? You forgot about keeping the Sabbath day. You see, what's going on here is right now, the purpose of the Ten Commandments, the purpose of the law, and the ones that are listed there, these are for Christians to keep, obviously. But there's no thing in there about keeping the Sabbath day. Why? Well, I have a whole study on it. I'm not going to get into it here. The Sabbath day is given for a sign to the Jews. The time of Jacob's trouble. Daniel's 70th week. It's for the Jews because they've rejected Jesus Christ. So, well, the Jews are the Christians. It's the church is the Christians. Well, okay, then why, if we have replaced Israel, why does God need to, for 7 years, correct us? Correct the body of Christ? Weird. Weird, this Catholic system of interpretation. That's what this whole thing is. Turn back to 1 Timothy chapter 1. Absolutely incredible. Just the nutty nonsense these people get themselves into. But you see there, 1 Timothy chapter 1, the law is given to convict sinners today of their sin so that they can come broken to the Lord and say, you know, I have to put my faith totally in you because there's nothing I can do on my own to save myself, you know, from an eternity in hell. That's the purpose of the law. But in the time of Jacob's trouble, it's part of your salvation. It goes back to keeping those Ten Commandments, specifically so the Sabbath day. You're not supposed to work. You're not allowed to, not supposed to. You're not allowed to work on the Sabbath day. But let's continue. Go to verse 12. It says here, and I thank Christ Jesus our Lord, who hath enabled me, for that he counted me faithful, putting me into the ministry, who was before a blasphemer and a persecutor and injurious, but I obtained mercy because I did it ignorantly in unbelief. Very interesting there. You mean somebody could be a blasphemer and still get saved? Today, sure, absolutely. But you see, in that time of Jacob's trouble, you take that mark of the beast, I don't care how sorry you are for doing it, you're going to hell. You say, well, I had a lapse in judgment and I just went and I took it and okay, I worshiped the beast too, you know, with the whole thing, it's part of the system. But I'd like to get saved. Sorry. Nope. You take the mark, worship the beast in his image, you go to hell. No exceptions. So then, why wouldn't Paul write something about that here in 1 Timothy? It's kind of strange why Paul would write all the Pauline epistles and yet never warn anybody about taking the mark of the beast. I mean, if there's something that so clearly in Revelation 14, verses 9 through 11, so clearly says if anybody takes it, if any man takes it, or whosoever receiveth the mark, if it's so clear, why wouldn't Paul say something about it if the body of Christ is going through that time? I'll give you a hint. Because we're not going through that time. I know that's hard for some people to understand, but try. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 17. Now unto the King eternal, immortal, invisible, the only wise God, be honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. So how does this prove a pre-trib rapture? Simple. Keep your hand there and turn to Revelation chapter 10 and verse 7. Revelation chapter 10, verse 7. But in the days of the voice of the seventh angel, when he shall begin to sound, the mystery of God should be finished, as he hath declared to his servants, the prophets. He's not going to be invisible anymore. You see there in later part of the book of Revelation, they're actually blaspheming God up in heaven and the saints in heaven, swearing profanities at God. There ain't going to be any mystery anymore. At the end of the time of Jacob's trouble, there will not be one atheist on the earth. Atheism is just Luciferianism. It's secular humanism is all it is. That's all it is. It's just another religion. But over here, Paul said that God's invisible. But the body of Christ goes into the time of Jacob's trouble, and he's not invisible. Why the inconsistency? Is Paul confused? Or is it that he's writing to a group of people that won't go there into the time of Jacob's trouble? I'll let you make up your own mind there. Look at verse 19 and 20. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 19 and 20. Holding faith and a good conscience, which some having put away concerning faith have made shipwreck, of whom is Hymenaeus and Alexander, whom I have delivered unto Satan, that they may learn not to blaspheme. So your life can be messed up. Your flesh can be delivered over to Satan for the destruction, the destruction of the flesh, I should say. Well, absolutely. I've seen that happen with Christians. They get to messing around with things. They get to messing around questioning God's word, and they get to messing around with the world and whatever else, and they'll fall sick. Something bad will happen to them. Why? God chastens them. That's why. Back when I first got saved, I still had some struggles with pornography addiction. And you know what? God chastened my flesh. A couple times, I almost was paralyzed in one of my accidents. Another time, I just about cut my thumb off. Why? Messing around. See, the Lord sometimes, if he sees some sin in your life, the Bible says back in Revelation chapter 12 that Satan is the accuser of the brethren. He stands before the throne. He accuses us day and night. He's looking for a reason that he can attack you. And when you mess around with sin, if you live after the flesh, ye shall die. Paul wrote that to Christians back in Romans chapter 6, I believe that is. When you live after the flesh, Satan has a right to attack you. But now, if Christians go into the time of Jacob's trouble, they could take the mark of the beast. Again, holding faith and a good conscience, which some having put away concerning faith have made shipwreck. Well, I'll tell you what, you go into the time of Jacob's trouble, it's more than a shipwreck. You lose your salvation. You see? No, you don't, because the body of Christ is not going to go into that time. It's just that simple. I mean, people, it's a very detailed thing. And no, it's not. It's very simple to understand. If you're saved, you are sealed until the day of redemption. That's not true for people in the time of Jacob's trouble. If you mess around with the flesh right now, you will die, but you aren't going to lose your salvation. Do you understand that? You mess around with the flesh, you'll be delivered to Satan for the destruction of the flesh. But you aren't going to lose your salvation. You got to get the differences in Scripture. 1 Timothy chapter 2, let's go to there now. Verses 1 through 4. I exhort therefore that first of all supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men. Keep going. For kings and for all that are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and to come unto the knowledge of the truth. You mean to tell me the body of Christ goes into this great tribulation, using their terms, the body of Christ goes into that time that we're supposed to pray for the Antichrist? Really? That we may lead a quiet and peaceable life when Jesus takes peace from the earth in Revelation chapter 6, verse 4? How does that work out? Let's just take the Bible and let's just stick it in a blender and just go and grind the whole thing up and say, it's all the same. It all teaches the same thing. That's what non-dispensational heretics do. like the Catholics. Non-dispensationalism is a papal belief. See, God had a holy nation that he was dealing with physically where they were going out and conquering nations back in the Old Testament. That's why the Catholic Church comes in and says, we are the New Testament church that has replaced that Old Testament, you know, church there, essentially. They believe replacement theology. Why? So that they can continue to fight physical wars for physical real estate. Why do you think the Vatican is in control of the modern day city of Jerusalem? It's a papal city right now. Interesting. But let's continue. Verse 5. We're going to go to... looking at my other notes here. I've got to put this piece of paper on so I'm not getting mixed up here. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verses 6 through 7. It says here, talking about the qualifications for a bishop. Not a novice, lest being lifted up with pride he fall into the condemnation of the devil. Moreover, he must have a good report of them which are without, lest he fall into reproach and the snare of the devil. Okay, if the body of Christ goes into the time of Jacob's trouble, how are saved preachers going to have a good report of them that are without? When the Bible says in that time period, Jesus talks about it back in the Gospels, that children are going to be causing their parents to be put to death. Families turning against each other. Oh, but Pastor so-and-so over at First Baptist Church, he's a good man. Are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? How on earth can people take this stuff in the Pauline epistles and say, this is going to apply to us today, and it applies to us the whole way through the book of Revelation, and even more magically than that, it goes through the millennial kingdom as well. The just shall live by faith. Hey, Jesus is over there physically present. You can go look at Jesus. He's in Jerusalem, the city of the great king, in the millennial kingdom, ruling and reigning there. But we're supposed to live by faith in the millennial kingdom. Faith is the evidence of things not seen. You must rightly divide the word of truth. If you don't, you make the Bible into a mess. And here we have it again. Right there. Have a good report of them which are without. How can a preacher do that in the time of Jacob's trouble? You're going to have to hide from the world if you go into that time period. If you're not saved right now and you miss the rapture and you go into that time period, you aren't going to be able to worship openly. Revelation chapter 13 talks about the whole world worshiping the beast. Why do you think the world is covered right now with Babel buildings? Phallic solar temples, Baal houses, goat sheds, whatever you want to call those stupid things that people call churches. There are no church buildings in the entire New Testament. Not one. Not once has God ever told anybody to build one. Not once. You know why people say, well, I know people that believe, you know, worship in church buildings and stuff. You know why they do it? Because they want to look credible. They want to have the respectable look of going to a church building with your little suit and tie on, a nice little Sunday dress and stuff like that. Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's why they do it. But let's continue. There's a lot more to go. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 through 6. Now remember, Paul is writing here, we're eventually going to see some instructions about Christians not taking the mark of the beast. All right? You say, well, a lot of this stuff is for the, you know, first century there. He's not really warning so much about the end times. Oh, really? 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1. Now the Spirit speaketh expressly. This is very emphatic, in other words, that the Holy Spirit is giving some express, very strong warnings about the last times. That in the latter times, some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. Is that true of today? Oh, yes. Verse 2, speaking lies in hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with a hot iron. Now look at the group that Paul attacks. Oh, it's such hate speech. Oh, it's so terrible. Verse 3, forbidding to marry and commanding to abstain from meats. which God hath created to be received with thanksgiving of them which believe and know the truth. What religious group, I won't name names. I will in a minute, just hold on. What religious group does those two things? Forbidding to marry and commanding to abstain from meats. Let me see. Catholicism. Oh, excuse me. I had a little cough there. The Roman Catholic Church. Okay? With the pervert priests raping small children, raping little children into the thousands, millions of little children have been raped by these pervert priests. NAMBLA. There was a pervert priest that was there at the organization's founding. They're disgusting. They sear their conscience with a hot iron. They're the ones that are being condemned here. They're not supposed to eat meat and stuff, I think, on the weekends or something like this, on Friday nights or something, you know, and all this other stuff. Yeah, sure. It's Catholics. Verse 4. For every creature of God is good and nothing to be refused if it be received with thanksgiving, for it is sanctified by the word of God and prayer. If thou put the brethren in remembrance of these things, thou shalt be a good minister of Jesus Christ, nourished up in the words of faith and of good doctrine, whereunto thou hast attained. Oh, Paul. Paul. I mean, the Spirit speaketh expressly. The Holy Spirit is speaking in a strong tone, saying, Paul, you have to warn people about the latter times. And yet Paul doesn't listen to the Holy Spirit. He doesn't warn anybody about not taking the mark of the beast. What an oversight of Paul. I mean, the body of Christ is clearly going through that because Christians have been martyred for centuries. And so therefore, he should have warned about not taking the mark of the beast. Oh, that's right. We're not going through it, as these studies have proven conclusively. God's word is crystal clear. The body of Christ is leaving before the time of Jacob's trouble, before Daniel's 70th week. And this Jesuitical sophistry tactic of calling this time period under the title the Great Tribulation. And then they'll show verses where it talks about Christians having tribulation in this life. And they say, see, Christians have tribulation. We go through the Great Tribulation. You know, no. Because nowhere in the King James Bible is the term the Great Tribulation or the Tribulation ever given as a title, as I say, over and over and over and over again. It's never given as a title. Absolutely incredible. Paul didn't warn about taking the mark of the beast for Christians. Why? Because we're not going to have to go through it. And don't tell me, oh, it was just for the first century Christians. He talks about the latter times. And the express warning that the Holy Spirit gives is about Catholicism and, ironically, vegetarianism. Watch out for professing Christians that are strongly, militantly vegetarian. I didn't say if they choose vegetarianism. It doesn't say that in the text. It says commanding to abstain from meats. When you have somebody that commands you to abstain from meats, you're dealing with somebody that has devils in them. Well, let's continue. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 8. One of you brought this up in the comments. I thought it was pretty good. We'll look at it here. For bodily exercise profiteth little, but godliness is profitable unto all things, having promise of the life that now is, and of that which is to come. We'll talk about that too. But look at the first part there. For bodily exercise profiteth little. Well, Paul, you're rather stupid again there, Apostle Paul. I mean, hey, man. Don't you understand, Paul? I mean, he was just kind of dumb and you know, probably maybe it was in the originals and it's just been lost over time. Yeah. I mean, hey, if we go into the time of Jacob's trouble, you're going to have to be in peak physical condition. I mean, you need to just quit soul winning, quit trying to tell people about the imminent catching away of the bride of Christ. No tracting, no, you don't have time for that. You had better start getting out into the woods and learning how to survive. You better become the ultimate prepper. I mean, study military tactics, study things, and just prepping. Just get yourself just ready to fight the forces of the Antichrist. Bodily exercise would profit a lot if you go into the time of Jacob's trouble. And by the way, if you are lost, if you have no desire, if you're laughing at me right now and mocking me, then you better start getting in real good shape. Unless, of course, you're going to take the mark of the beast and be damned to hell forever. Well, you know, then sit there and eat potato chips and junk food and drink soda pop and whatever else. You know, it's not going to matter to you. But if you're going to go into that time, if you're a post-tribber, get offline. Just cut off the internet and start prepping. And part of that prepping is going to be, you better start to exercise your body because you're going to be running for 7 years. Hunted down like a wild animal. But look at the second part of that verse. Verse 8. Having promise of the life that now is, your salvation right now as a living Christian, and of that which is to come. Having promise? Who promised? Oh, that would be the Holy Spirit of promise that you read about in Ephesians chapter 1. Another proof text proving that the body of Christ leaves before the time of Jacob's trouble. And again, you know, I see this Jacob Prash. I never even heard of the guy. One of you posted a comment about it, and they said Jacob Prash is like radically, vehemently anti-pre-trib rapture. And of course, they use the Jesuitical thing. Oh, I have friends that are pre-trib, and I have friends that are post-trib, and I have friends that are Catholic Jesuits, and I have friends that worship Satan, and friends that are sodomites, and friends that are transsexuals, and transgender, and whatever. And I have friends in everywhere, and we can agree to disagree. That's Catholic. That's Catholic. Let me tell you something. If you have a bunch of wicked, reprobate sinners as your friends, and you get along with them, and you can sit down and have coffee and donuts and tea together, and not get into radical yelling arguments and have them say, "You stay away from me, you fanatic." If you can do that, you're not saved. Okay? If you are saved, even if you are shy and quiet and whatever else, you're not going to get along with the lost world. It'll eventually get to a point where they're going to have a blow up and it's going to be a confrontation and things are going to fall apart. So don't give me that stuff. But this Jacob Prash and Joe Schimmel and a bunch of these other guys now, they're coming out and they're saying, "I have a challenge to pre-trippers. Show me one verse of scripture that says pre-tribulation rapture." Like that proves anything, you know. I mean, we're supposed to go through the Bible and base all of our doctrines on one scripture, you know. And see that you say, well, there's actually no verse that says the words pre-tribulation rapture. Why? Because it's a false term. It's a false term that they invented. The papists invented it, you know. So, you know, I can't prove this thing. And it's so funny because they'll say, that's why I believe in a post-trib rapture. Wait a second. Let me get this straight. You don't believe in a pre-trib rapture because that phrase is not in the King James Bible or any Bible. But you believe in a post-trib rapture, which phrase also does not appear. You know? And they'll say, well, the Bible says in Matthew 24, immediately after the tribulation. Well, why don't you keep reading there, sunshine? Immediately after the tribulation of those days. The tribulation is not a title. And you keep reading in the context there, it's not talking about a rapture. It's talking about Jesus Christ coming back and the holy angels with him. And you do the study, those holy angels are saints that have gone up. They won't talk about that. You know, see, they don't like stuff like that. But let's continue. 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 8, another real doozy for you if you believe that Christians go through the time of Jacob's trouble. 1 Timothy 5, verse 8, "But if any provide not for his own, and especially for those of his own house, he hath denied the faith, and is worse than an infidel." Wait a second here. No man might buy or sell save he that had the mark. Revelation chapter 13. But this says, if I don't provide for my own, I've denied the faith, and I'm worse than an infidel. Well, how does that work? Revelation 14, verses 9 through 11 says, if I take the mark, I go to hell. So let me get this straight. If I'm a post-tribber, I have to be able to take the mark. Otherwise, I've denied the faith and I'm worse than an infidel. But by taking the mark, I go to hell. In layman's terms, it goes like this. Cuckoo, 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 cuckoo. Or... I mean, It's so crystal clear, people. I mean, come on. Give me a break. And if you're you know, believing that the rapture is coming soon and things, and you don't understand that we're not going to go through the time of Jacob's trouble, don't let these post-trib heretics, these papists, don't let them shake your faith. All right, we're leaving, and it's, I don't know how soon, you know. We're down here because there's still people that need to be saved. The Lord's still giving you a chance to be saved if you're lost, you know. But don't let these stupid heretics take your faith. I mean, it's just so crystal clear. Give me a break. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 12 through 15. It says here, fight the good fight of faith, lay hold on eternal life, whereunto thou art also called, and hast professed a good profession before many witnesses. I give thee charge in the sight of God, who quickeneth all things, and before Christ Jesus, who before Pontius Pilate witnessed a good confession, that thou keep this commandment without spot, unrebukable, until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which in his times he shall show, who is the blessed and only potentate, the King of kings and Lord of lords. In other words, we're supposed to serve Jesus until the rapture. And Jesus is going to straighten things out at his second coming. You say, well, I think that if we can vote Donald Trump in, you know, maybe we can have a chance to restore the republic. Come on. Give me a break, people. I mean, how do you think Donald Trump got into the position he's in? Huh? Multi-billionaire? With hard work and dedication. it's just disgusting. A fornicating slob that's Jesuit trained, and God's for him. Huh? You know, the Bible says, love not the world, neither the things that be in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father's not in him. That temptation's there for a Christian. To love the world enough to say, I want to see America come back to the glory days. I want to see all the prosperity that we've enjoyed in the past. You want to see it so bad that you'd be willing to vote for a Jesuit trained pervert. It's a problem. 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 17 through 19. Charge them that are rich in this world, that they be not high-minded, nor trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God, who giveth us richly all things to enjoy, that they do good, that they be ready, or that they be rich in good works, ready to distribute, willing to communicate, laying up in store for themselves a good foundation against the time to come, that they may lay hold on eternal life. We'll look at a couple other scriptures, and then we'll come back to this. Matthew chapter 6, verse 19. Turn to Matthew chapter 6, verse 19. You're going to see this thing crosses dispensational lines. Matthew chapter 6, verse 19 through 21 says, lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Where's your heart at? Where's your treasure at? Because where your treasure is, that's where your heart is. Turn to Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3. Verses 1 through 3. You see, well, that was Jesus speaking on the Sermon on the Mount there, so that was for the you know, constitution for the millennial kingdom. Well, that's very true. But guess what? It's for us today, too. Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 through 3. If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affections on things above, not on things on the earth. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. Where's your heart? Where's your treasure? They're in the same place. Very interesting. Turn now to James, the book of James, chapter 5. James chapter 5, verses 1 through 3. Go to now, ye rich men, weep and howl for your miseries that shall come upon you. Your riches are corrupted, and your garments are moth-eaten. Your gold and silver is cankered, and the rust of them shall be a witness against you, and shall eat your flesh as it were fire. Ye have heaped treasure together for the last days. Now let me get into your personal business, Christian. Turn back to 1 Timothy chapter 6. What are you doing with your money? And I'm making a pitch for money. I'm not trying to say I need $1 million or I'm not going to continue in the ministry or something like that. I'm not doing that. But let me ask you a question. Are you saving up for retirement? You know how much I have in my 401k plan right now? Zero. You say you have a 401k plan? No, I don't. I don't even have that. How much do I have saved up for retirement? Well, that depends on what retirement we're talking about. You see, years and years ago, I got under conviction and I got saved. And the Lord showed me there aren't people out there preaching the truth. And I tried and I tried and I tried to get under ministries and under preachers and things like this, Baptist pastors and stuff, that would I could be there and I could be in ministry. And I saw the same thing over and over and over again. Compromise, taking light out towards Catholicism, not even talking about Catholicism, not even speaking against it. And I was told not to speak against Catholicism at these places. And I quickly realized, if I'm going to do something for the Lord, it's going to have to be between me and Him. And I'm going to have to find a platform that I can speak up for Jesus Christ without the authority of some other man over top of me. And you know what? At that point in time, I put it all on the altar. And I said, I'm willing to do this, Lord, no matter what it costs me. And I have been through some very, very, very difficult financial times. But you know what? I can say with assurance that there are treasures waiting for me in heaven. I know that now. I didn't know it years ago. But when I rededicated my life to Jesus, well, when I got saved and then dedicated my life to Jesus Christ, I'll say it that way. When I did that, I didn't have much in my heavenly retirement account. But you know, there are people out there that say, well, brother, I'm not called into the same kind of ministry. I'm not saying that you should be. But you know what? I've seen this thing many, many times. We get donations sometimes from people, and I know it costs them something. And they say, brother, I really wish we could send more, but I just lost my job, and boy, we're really having a hard time. But you've been such a blessing to me, and I just want to do something. And I've gotten coins, a few coins in an envelope. Not always a good idea because it gets through the machines in the postal system, and it rips the things and then the coins go flying. But, I get donations sometimes. Somebody sends me a dollar bill. And I know it means something to them to send that dollar bill. I praise the Lord for that. But you people out there that are saving up and saving up and saving up because, well, hey, what if the rapture doesn't happen? I mean, we could still be here in another 20 years, you waiting for the Lord's to... Let me ask you a question. Let's just say for a minute that we are still here in 20 years and that the Lord Jesus Christ does not come back for another 20 years. Do you think the American economy is going to last for 20 years? I'll give you a hint. No. Our gold and silver that was supposed to be our coins, according to the United States Constitution, it was taken from us. Our gold back in the 1930s with FDR, our silver under Lyndon Baines Johnson in 1965, and the copper pennies were taken from us in 1982. They took it from us. And you say, I got it beat though, brother, because you see, I've been saving up gold and silver coins. American Eagles and things like this, and Liberty Dollars and whatever. Okay, and who do you think is in control of the gold and silver market? What's all the manipulation about? And I followed that thing for years. I used to recommend gold and silver and stuff. And, I have some silver coins and things like that. But if you think I'm relying on that, no, I'm not. I think that the woman's name is Catherine Albrecht or something like that, if I remember correctly. And she was a World Bank employee or something like this. And she openly said, I saw an interview years ago of her, and she said, the Jesuits are the ones that are controlling the price fluctuations with the gold and silver. It's controlled by the Vatican. So you can hoard up all the gold and silver that you want, and the Vatican can just drive that stuff down to where it's about as valuable as scrap metal. You see, our text says here in 1 Timothy chapter 6, nor trust in uncertain riches. Uncertain riches are what we have down here on this earth. Certain riches are what's up in heaven. That's what you can store up there. And I'm telling you, if you are storing up your money, first of all, you can lose it all very quickly in a financial collapse. The economy is going to collapse eventually. I mean, it's prophesied in Scripture that there's going to be a one-world cashless system. So what in the world are you doing hoarding all the money? You say, well, brother, you know, what if I would give it away to ministries and things? And again, I'm not trying to say, oh, you know, send me everything you have. I'm not trying to say that, brethren. I'm instructing you. I'm giving you some exhortation here. All right? Give it to the Lord, wherever you give it, wherever you decide to give it. But what happens if you say, well, brother, you know, what if I give my money away and then I have to have that money? Don't you think God can provide for you? You really think that if you give it willingly to the Lord, that he's going to let you stick sometime? You know, there's an old saying, you can't outgive God. And I believe in that. I believe in that firmly. And I'll tell you, one of the big frustrations for me in this ministry has been many, many times that we've just gone into a financial slump and the donations and things go down. And I'll tell you, I know a lot of other ministries that go through the same thing. And I'm thinking to myself, what in the world is the body of Christ doing? 401k plans, retirement plans, money, money, money. Just save it up, hoard it up, hoard it up, hoard it up. Do you realize who's going to get it at the rapture? Do you realize? All the money that you have left, all of your belongings, this whole thing right here, all of my books, my wife and I's books, everything, all of our belongings in here and everything like that, going to be the property of the state, the Vatican State, and ultimately the Antichrist. And your bank account, I mean, somebody could come in here, break in here, and get what they need. You know, hopefully whoever comes here is going to get a couple of the King James Bibles up there on the top shelf. Hopefully they'll take this one, my old Bible, my old faithful Cambridge Bible. I hope that they're smart enough to do that. I'm hoping that they're smart enough to take some of the videos and things that I have around here and whatever to learn the Bible. I hope that that happens. But my point is, what you have in the bank, there ain't going to be anybody breaking in there and taking your cash out of some little magic box that's there at the bank or whatever. Your cash that you have in the bank is a number on a computer. And when the rapture happens, it's gone. It becomes the property of the state. But the Lord's sure going to reward you when you get up there to heaven. And he looks and he says, wow, you had $500,000 in the bank saved up. Boy, you worked hard for that. What's it going to mean to you in eternity? You better think about that. Verse 18, that they do good, that they be rich in good works, ready to distribute, willing to communicate, laying up in store for themselves a good foundation against the time to come, that they may lay hold on eternal life. What are you doing with the money that God's given you? Are you willing to distribute that? Are you willing to look out there for ministries that need help and say, I'm going to give this to you? And you say, what about you? We need help. I don't make a lot of money. And you know, there have been many, many times when the ministry's wanting to surge forward and I'm seeing growth and all kinds of potential, and it's just like, it slows down. The giving goes down, it slows the ministry down. I have to start saying, okay, I got to find other ways to make money. I got to find other things that I can do. It takes me away from what I'm supposed to be doing. That's why Paul said in Philippians chapter 4 about he's not desiring a gift, but he's desiring fruit that may abound to your account. That's what giving to the ministry is all about. You see? And there are some other good ministries out there, and I hear these guys and they're going, you just got to, you know, beat Christians over the head with this thing and just say, don't hold on to all your money. Don't think that you're going to keep it safe in some bank account somehow and it's going to be somehow preserved through the time of Jacob's trouble and you come back down in the millennial kingdom and it'll be waiting for you with 7 years of interest. That's not going to happen. Whatever money you have at the rapture, it's going to the Antichrist system. And I hate to tell you, it's already in it. You know, you got $200,000 in the bank, they're investing your money in what they want. They're not investing your money in Christian quote-unquote charities. They're not doing it. They're investing in the stock market. The more money you have in the bank, the more they are investing your money. And you have no say in the matter. Why don't you give some money through the Lord's work? Why don't you make sure that you have treasures laid up in heaven? Just a challenge, brethren. Let's close with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, I do thank you for your precious promises that we don't have to worry about going through a time when we could lose our salvation, that we don't have to worry about having to be further purified. Lord, your word says if we are saved, we are washed in the blood, our sins are paid for. There's no more purification needed. I thank you for that, Lord. And I do pray that if there's someone out there who is lacking in their faith, they don't think that you can provide for them in the future, that person, that man or woman or whoever, that they would think about that and that they would find some ministries to distribute to so that those ministries can continue, so that they can earn rewards at the judgment seat of Christ, which is what our life is all about. I do pray for that, Lord. And I pray that you would please protect this ministry, that you would help us to continue fighting against this evil Vatican system. And I just pray, Lord, for those out there that are continually dogged by these papal heretics that are trying to destroy their faith and you taking us out of here. I pray, Lord, that they would stand by your word and not be shaken by these liars. And I just ask it all in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Okay, that's going to be it for this study. Please do keep us in your prayers. The ministry expenses, it's a never-ending thing. I mean, we are always having to buy research materials. I've stated at different times, you know, there's always the danger of cameras breaking down, computers breaking down. We don't have a huge bank account, okay? Just to be very, very blunt. We want to be a lot more efficient than we are. And we have the opportunity coming up to be able to witness to thousands of people. But it's going to take a good amount of money. And we are saving up, and Lord willing, we will be able to fulfill the plans that we have that the Lord has been laying on our hearts. But it's going to take a lot of money. And I don't mean millions or even $100,000. It's going to be less than that. But the point is, it's going to take some money to be able to do what we want to do. And it's right now, it's just a matter of we're saving as much as we can. We're really scrimping on a lot of things that we would normally do as far as even nutrition and things. Because we are really, really trying to get work done for the Lord in the time that we have. You know, and another thing is, too, the Bible talks about a man of understanding, you know, for the iniquity of land, many are the transgressions thereof, or I can't think of the verse, I don't have it written down here, but it says, but by a man of understanding shall the state thereof be prolonged. If you're enjoying your life right now in America, and we have a lot to be thankful for in this country, you know why it is? It's because of ministries. And I have to say this, ministries like this one that are standing by the book. Again, you know, I'm not just a little internet guy that has a web camera or something. This is a ministry. This existed before going online. King James Video Ministries has been around for basically since 2007, if you want to go back to when it actually was really happening, 2007. So we've been around for a while. And we're going to continue by God's grace. And our project that the Lord has laid upon our hearts, Lord willing, it'll happen. How soon that occurs is really up to the Lord providing. You know, you say, well, why don't you go out and get a job? Well, I could do that. I could absolutely do that. But the problem with that is then less videos, less people getting saved, less lives being changed. If the Lord, I want you to pray about it. If the Lord lays it on your heart, get in contact with me. I have no problem explaining to people I'm not going to be putting a lot of this stuff online, how our where our finances go to and everything, because people just would pick it apart and it would just be, it just it'd get really carnal. And but you know, if you want to know what I'm talking about and things, you know, please just get in contact with me. I had a brother actually write and he sent us a donation, and he said maybe in the future you could do some kind of a thing where you'd have like a quarterly or something financial report for the ministry. I'm considering that. I'm praying about that. We don't waste money. Believe you me. I mean, we don't waste money. We are not, we don't go out to eat. We really don't go on any kind of vacation. We drive old vehicles. We live in a very cheap place here. I mean, we, you know, buy secondhand clothes. I mean, we are not, you know, spendthrift type of people. And, you know, it also disturbs me a lot of times when I see people that really comment a lot on my channel and really tell me what I should and shouldn't be doing, and yet they don't give a cent to this ministry. That's always bothered me. I've gotten that thing since the very beginning of the ministry. That's always irritated me, you know. But then I see those people like the believers in Macedonia, the Bible talks about that in their deep poverty, they give the riches of their liberality. Their deep poverty causes them to say, I really am thankful for this ministry because it's one of the few online that we can trust. And they give abundantly. They give. And I'm not saying, I mean, good night. If you can't put food on the table or something, take, you know, put some food on the table, okay? But the Lord will provide for you too. I don't forget that either. And so please keep us in your prayers. Very, very serious, fervent prayer is needed right now. We have a very big project that we're trying to accomplish, and it's going to make the ministry a lot more effective. This place here is very difficult. It's continually needing my work, my attention. We go through a lot of things that I don't really talk a whole lot about, but I just, if you've donated to the ministry, thank you so much. God will bless you. We pray for God's blessing to be upon those who donate to this ministry. But, you know, it's a big prayer request. I'm not going to say much more about that right now. But please do keep us in your prayers. And please, please do not be shaken by these post-trib heretics. And the more I look at the thing, the more I'm convinced that it comes from Rome, this whole post-trib thing. I mean, I've showed it up here in the catechism. You know, it's in the catechism that the church needs to go through a final time of purification, the tribulation, you know. They say it right in the catechism. So post-tribism, any form of it, be it pre-wrath or post-trib or any of this, any kind of purification that's further purification that's needed other than the blood of Jesus Christ, it's papal. It's works-based salvation. And it's departing from doctrine. So the doctrine that the Pauline epistles teach. So that is going to be it. I'm not going to keep rambling here. But we do thank you. And also, most importantly, please keep praying for us. We do feel your prayers. There have been so many times that I've just felt God's people praying. We get discouraged and we're down, and you can just feel people praying. So thank you so much for that. And we will see you. Not sure if it's going to be next week. Had a couple things come up here and couldn't get it done for Sunday, but I'm trying to keep these coming out on the fairly about consistently on a week basis, these studies in the Pauline epistles on the rapture. We'll see you in the next video. So I have a few other videos I'm going to be doing here. But just really, I thank you out there, everybody, for your support, for your prayers. That's going to be it. See you in the next video.